Hello and welcome, everybody. And thank you all for joining us on this, our third summer forum of 2021, summer of 2021. We are happy to have you all here and are also very happy and excited about today's program and about our guests. We have two speakers today who are going to be talking with us about the inland port. So we're very excited and happy to have, this is the first summer forum so far where we've had two speakers. So we're really looking forward to that. And the way that it will work is that after we introduce our guests, they will present in sequence. So and that will be about 40 minutes in total, and then we'll have a quick break when we can have a few minutes to ourselves. And there will be an interlude. There will also be an option and links for donations. If anybody would like to give us a donation to help us make sure we can keep doing this. And then there will be a Q&A section right after that. For the Q&A section, please post your questions to our chat. And those questions, as many of the questions as we can get to in the time that we have, we will ask our guests. All right. So with that being said, I will hand over the mic, or the proverbial mic, to Joan Gregory, who will be introducing our speakers.
Thank you, Dylan. And as Dylan mentioned, today we have two speakers, Dr. Brian Moench and Deeda Seed. Dr. Brian Moench is the president and founder of Utah Physicians for a Healthy Environment, which has become one of the largest civic organizations of healthcare professionals in the Western U.S. Dr. Moench is a former member of the University of Utah Honors Program faculty, teaching public health and the environment. He chaired the Holy Cross Hospital Department of Anesthesia and was in private practice in anesthesiology at Holy Cross Hospital, LDS Hospital, and Intermountain Medical Center from 1981 until his recent retirement. You may recognize Dr. Moench for his advocacy for clean air and a healthy environment through presentations, lectures, rallies, op-eds, and press conferences. He's written two nonfiction books on environmental issues, Death by Corporation and The Great Brain Robbery, How Women Have Become Smarter Than Men, Science with an Attitude. He has helped communities in Utah, Texas, Pennsylvania, California, Alaska, Nevada, and British Columbia organize opposition to polluting industries. He has been an expert witness and has written court briefs for pollution lawsuits, has met with top EPA officials, and was nominated by the Obama administration at a Washington, D.C. conference as one of 50 finalists to receive the award Champion of Change for his work on global warming. Our second speaker is Deeda Seed. Deeda is the public lands senior campaigner at the Center for Biological Diversity. The center works to secure a future for all species, great and small, hovering on the brink of extinction. They do this work through science, law, and creative media with a focus on protecting the lands, waters, and climate that species need to survive. Before joining the center, Deeda worked for 10 years for the Southern Utah Wilderness Alliance, where she organized support for Utah's Red Rock Wilderness. Over her 30-year career as an activist and organizer in Utah, she worked on a wide range of social justice, civil rights, and environmental issues. Deeda also served a 4-year term on the Salt Lake City Council and was chief of staff and communications director in the administration of Salt Lake City Mayor Rocky Anderson. Please welcome Dr. Brian Moench and Deeda Seed as they share their experience in working to stop the polluting Utah inland port. Brian will speak first.
Thanks, Joan. I'm going to try and share my screen now. All right, thanks to everybody for coming this morning. I first want to mention that it was my birthday a couple of days ago. And for those of you who forgot to get me a birthday present, I really don't want much, but I do want a couple of things. First, I want the entire Trump family in jail. Second, I want a functional democracy. If you can't arrange either one of those, then I'd like you to arrange for me a livable climate. If you can't manage that, then please arrange to have Tucker Carlson come mow my lawn, except for I don't have a lawn. And I want to be equally critical of both political parties. So if you can't arrange any of that, I'd like you to arrange for Democrats to grow a spine, for Mitch McConnell to have some giant kidney stones, Rupert Murdoch to have his diapers changed in a nursing home by Representative Maxine Waters. If someone can help teach Representative Marjorie Taylor Greene how to read, that would be helpful. How about AOC as president? Can we make Ted Cruz mute? And maybe we ought to talk about the Supreme Court. But if you can't arrange for any of that, let's talk about air quality. Now it's not letting me advance. Now it's frozen up. Let me see if I can fix this. Maybe we ought to next go to Deeda while I see if I can, if there's anything I can fix from my end.
All righty. Deeda, are you able to take it away?
Well, we'll see.
All right.
I'm going to try.
Sounds good.
Okay. So this picture is a picture of the top of the photo is what the area we're trying to protect looks like now. The bottom is a picture of an inland port. This is the south shore of Great Salt Lake. It's really beautiful and it's just so very endangered right now from all sorts of development, including, but not limited to the inland port. And we'll talk about that in a second. Here's some pelicans. I just wanted to show people what we're trying to protect. This area around the inland port is a very important area for pelicans, which, you know, they're increasingly desperate as other bodies of water in the western United States dry up. This is a bad photo of antelope that I took. There's a herd of antelope in the area. This is not my photo, so it's a good antelope photo. let's see. Oh, now I'm stuck. Oh. So this is what's happening right now to the antelope. They're being hemmed in by the development that's happening out there. All right, so when I said the south shore of the Great Salt Lake is under threat, what do I mean? Well, can you see my cursor?
Yes.
So here, this green blob is the Utah Inland Port jurisdictional area that was created by the Utah legislature in 2018. And this is primarily what we'll talk about today. But I also wanted you all to know that there are other development pressures in this area and we need to be aware of all of this. So right here is, and these are wetlands in here, is a plan for a very high density housing development on a green field. And then over here, Josh Romney has been working to create an inland port in Tooele. So there's lots of pressure on the south shore of Great Salt Lake. So why is this area important? Well, it's bird habitat for up to 10 million migratory birds a year from over 300 species. These are marbled godwits. And increasingly these birds are finding, you know, fewer and fewer places to go because of the drought, because of climate change. And we're in a mega drought. We know that now across the Western United States. So species are very imperiled right now. Much more so than they ever have been. And some of you may know that we've lost, I think it's a third of a population of birds in the last 30 years in North America. Okay, so this is a map of the Utah Inland Port jurisdictional area. And where my cursor is going up here are wetlands that are currently very critical, but then all throughout the area are wetlands. This area is the International Center. This is I-80. This area is a green field, basically. It has not been developed ever, and it's the area that we're most concerned about right now, because it's adjacent to these critical wetlands, and it's never been developed. So the implications of developing it in terms of creating pollution and climate emissions are just huge. The south side is already somewhat industrialized, and the Salt Lake City landfill is in here. It's an area that also needs attention. It's also bird habitat, but it, a different kind of attention than the area north of I-80. So after they created the inland port in Salt Lake City and took control over the area and basically all the future property tax revenue, and the they being the legislature, in 2019, they decided they wanted to expand the concept, and they're intending to create satellite ports throughout the state. And these circles on these maps were drawn by county commissioners imagining where they would like satellite ports to be located. Satellite ports, in many instances, in their view, would be fossil fuel transloading facilities. And again, from our perspective, that is absolutely the wrong thing to be investing public money in right now. If you all looked outside today, I mean, we're in a horrible crisis, and we need to get our priorities straight. And spending taxpayer money on fossil fuel infrastructure of any kind or polluting endeavors of any kind like the inland port is just wrong. So moving on, sorry, I got on my soapbox. Okay, so what's an inland port? Well, there's a huge inland port in Ilwood, Illinois, that was profiled in a New Republic article, I think it was in 2019. And they're basically huge warehouse and freight transfer facilities that can include rail yards, other kinds of transloading facilities. In our case, they may be thinking about including the airport, although we don't have any details about that, but certainly lots of warehouses. And here's a schematic of what they want to do. This, again, you're looking at the area north of I-80, and we're looking to the east, so we're over here. This is the International Center. But they wanted to, you know, just basically a sea of warehouses. There's nothing special. These are not environmentally sound warehouses. They're just like every other dirty, polluting warehouse in the world. And by the way, there are no green ports, no green inland ports. And one of the reasons is the technology doesn't exist to create something like that. But I get ahead of myself. Okay, so what's happening here is that, and this is a schematic from the developers, and it's changed a little bit. Now, this piece of property is owned by the State Institutional Trust Lands Administration, SITLA, and it's not going to be an intermodal rail yard, although there may be some rail associated with it. But basically, what we've got happening here is lots of new truck trips and lots of new car trips. So what are our concerns? Well, pollution, Brian will talk about air pollution in a minute. Water pollution is an issue. Water quantity is an issue. Again, the drought should be of concern to all of us. And Great Salt Lake is drying up. That's the other thing. And there are intensive water users that are seeking to develop in this area. Noise pollution is an issue. Light pollution, greenhouse gas emissions, of course, environmental injustice. The communities that are going to be most impacted most directly are our West Side communities that are our most diverse communities and historically have suffered disproportionately from these polluting uses. Take, you know, the refineries, that's the freeways, et cetera. And this is just adding insult to injury. And then habitat loss that I was talking about earlier. So this is a picture of what's happening now. This is a stormwater detention. It's just to show you that they're not doing anything special. They're doing the least expensive thing they can get away with. So this is a map of all the wetlands and playas in the area. And for your orientation, here's I-80. Here's our real area of concern. And this is all this really super critical bird habitat. But you can see even interspersed in the area that they seek to develop, there are wetlands. For example, this is a huge chunk of wetlands that's owned by Rio Tinto. So greenhouse gas emissions are a huge issue. And Brian points out that, you know, even if they do electrify the electric in some way, in some, it's probably only would it be in a small way, that that electricity is being provided by coal-fired power plants. You know, community impacts are huge. This is Meadowlark Elementary School is right next to the boundary of the proposed polluting port. And here's the principal of the school. He was interviewed. You know, you can see the playground is right next to this freeway. I-15 that's going to have potentially tens of thousands of additional diesel truck trips because of the port. Satellite ports I talked about already, and there's the map again. Okay, so who benefits? Well, Rio Tinto is a major landowner in the area, and at one point they were talking about putting conservation easements on the land they own, but now they're apparently all in for development. So what are our current concerns? Well, this is a picture of the budget that they just passed, and you can see that they are going from $5 million last year. They amended their budget to $21 million, and now and then they're going up to $40 million, and they've got these line items on here. This is all taxpayer money, by the way. I think the thing that really gets me angry about this is that we are paying for this. The developers have been very clear that they can't afford to do this without a huge subsidy from taxpayers. So, you know, we're paying for the destruction of our own community and for them to make money. It's really, really, really irritating. Sorry, soapbox again. So $40 million in taxpayer money for next year, and we don't know what these things are at all. I can't tell you. Row right-of-way acquisition for $1.2 million. Your guess is as good as mine. We believe that taxpayers have the right to know how their money is spent, especially when it's being spent for something that's so destructive. So what are we doing? We're fighting back. This is a picture from a press conference we held in, 2020, maybe February of 2020. I have that pandemic time warp thing where I can't keep track of what year it is. anyway, we wrote a report, and the we, I should say who the we is. Well, the we is a lot of Unitarians. We have very strong support from the Unitarian community and are so grateful for it. But our coalition is a loose coalition of organizations and people who are concerned about this project. We're very organic in our construction. People come and go as their lives, you know, unfold and bring their skills and talents. And so this was a press conference where we released a report that our volunteer members put together that really describes the harms from the port. We do tabling. So okay, this is the display I made. I know it looks like a sixth grade science fair display, but this was at the Night Out Against Crime in 2018, where we're recruiting people and educating them, getting them to sign our petition. And over here, you can see we're right next to the port developers. And this guy right here, Ben Hart, is on the Port Authority Board. These, you know, early days in 2018. We've attended every single Port Authority board meeting and provided robust public comment in opposition to every single board meeting. Our allied organizations have held different kinds of creative events. So Salt Lake Air Protectors did this event on the location of the port. And this is Carl Moore, who was a board member of the Salt Lake Air Protectors. We had the mayor come and talk to us. This was after she filed litigation that we had called for suing the Port Authority and the state. Here's council member Dan Dugan. He's now a council member. He was at this meeting as a candidate And now he's a member of the Salt Lake City Council, and he's a champion of our cause. And we're looking to be very engaged in the council races coming up. So we've done lots of press conferences. Here's Georgie Corkery. She's a graduate student at Utah State University this coming year, working on wetlands issues. She's speaking at a press event that we held in, I believe it was the autumn of 2019. We did a rally during a blizzard. It resulted in, this was awesome, a headline story in the Deseret News, and all those kids holding those signs are BYU students. Again, with the meetings, lots and lots of meetings. Oops. There's Stan. Stan Holmes is, I believe, a member of the Unitarian Church. He is the leader of our satellite port team. We've had like, oops, I should go back. Sorry, I'm all over the place now. We've had like over 100 Zoom meetings. Zoom is a curse and a blessing, but we've really been able to maximize Zoom and keep working on projects even when it was not safe for us to be in person together. But we were in person together just a few weeks ago at a press conference that we held outside of the new development just before the Port Authority board meeting, where they adopted this $40 million budget. And here's Afa Kona and her kids. She lives in the Rose Park area. She's somebody that has been through a fight like this before, because when she lived in Southern California, they successfully stopped a big intermodal rail yard from being built. And I should just stop here and say that Southern California has a lot of experience with inland ports. The Inland Empire, which is this area inland from the ports of LA and Long Beach, is basically a giant inland port. And it's 152 million square feet of warehouse space, which is exactly the amount of warehouse space that developers want to develop in our city, in Salt Lake City. And the Inland Empire in California is known as the diesel death zone. So, you know, what we're talking about here is trying to prevent a diesel death zone in our community. And we're very grateful that AFA is working with us on this. And there's another picture from our press conference. So what can you do? You can get involved. You can go to stopthepollutingport.org and you click yes, sign me up, and you'll get on our list, and you'll get invitations to our meetings and other things that are happening. So our current work is, well, I said the pandemic can't stop us. We've met over 100 times. And we also have work teams that meet. So right now we're very focused on this transloading facility that the Port Authority is talking about building. We have very, very little concrete information about it. I noticed that Mayor Mendenhall's coming to speak at this forum next week. People should ask her about Salt Lake City's engagement on this issue. They've been somewhat helpful, but a little hard to, it's like we're not quite getting everything we need from them. And we'd like a little more help. Because they're part of this too. And actually they enabled some of this really bad stuff to happen. I think now they realize that that was a mistake, but we do need engagement from Salt Lake City. So we're also asking for a traffic study, which the mayor has said she supports. This traffic study would show everyone in the public what the projected new amounts of truck traffic and car traffic would be coming from the port. And it also would serve as a foundation for something else we want, which is a human health risk assessment. We deserve to know what those harms and consequences of this development will be for our community. And that assessment has not been done. The Port Authority is just trying to paint a picture of, oh, don't worry about it. And then they'll say it's going to be green with no details. Which is just really disturbing. So anyway, the mayor is on board. We've heard the mayor of Mill Creek, who is the chair of the Wasatch Front Regional Council, is also on board. And we may have some support in Davis County. And there's a good editorial in the Tribune today that suggests that this needs to happen. So then another thing we're working on is getting the attention of the Environmental Protection Agency. I think Brian will talk about that. He's leading that effort. The issues of accountability and transparency I've already referenced, but we really need accountability when our money is being used for this project. We need to watch the satellite ports. Those might be moving now soon. The legislature in this last session created a port piggy bank for satellite ports with $75 million in it. And that money might start being spent. And then we really need to track the wetlands and water issues. So we're creating a water committee. I mean, we're very concerned that this development will actually contribute to the death of Great Salt Lake by dewatering the area. And again, you can, got ahead of myself. You can join us by going to stopthepollutingport.org. And then here's just a beauty shot. Like, this is what we're trying to protect. We live in one of the most amazing places in the nation, and we have to fight to save it, because if the powers that be have their way, things are going to become more grim. But here's my message of hope. People power makes a difference. You all know it, because the Unitarian Church has a long history of persistence and movements for civic and racial justice, social justice, economic justice, and environmental justice. And this issue has a lot of those things woven into it. So we need to keep up this fight for our community. And with that, I'm going to stop sharing and turn it over to Brian, who hopefully now can work his slideshow. You could see mine didn't work exactly either.
Well, yeah. let's give this a shot here. Okay, let's try this again with feeling. Second go around. This is one of two pictures I want you to look at here for just a second. Here's the first, and here's the second. It will forward slides, great. Okay, so one of these two pictures is a screenshot of a dystopian sci-fi movie. The other was taken in a Western city last September. That one or that one? Which do you think is which? I'm gonna show you. The first one is Blade Runner, supposedly in the year 2049. The second was taken in San Francisco last September. There doesn't seem to be an awful lot of difference between the two. And in fact, I would say we are already knocking on the door of a dystopian future for multiple reasons. Now, a lot of us live along the Wasatch Front because of scenery like this. And wouldn't it be wonderful if that's in fact what this place looked like? That's what it should look like. But all too often, it doesn't look like that. Okay, so this is what all too often our air quality looks like. Why is that? Why are we in this situation? And by the way, this is the Division of Air Quality's alert, unhealthy for sensitive groups. And let me be very clear, this is a badly out of date government warning. This level of air quality is unhealthy for sensitive groups. That is, if everybody who has a pair of lungs is considered a sensitive group. It is actually disingenuous and, in my opinion, harmful for the government to put out warnings like this, because it gives a false sense of comfort to people who think they are not part of a sensitive group. Why are we in this situation? Because of the climate crisis. Now, I want to say that we should all start talking about the climate crisis in that term instead of climate change. And in fact, other people are now recommending that we talk about it in terms of climate catastrophe. The term climate fires is what the governor of Washington now recommends we call wildfires, because they are largely the product of the climate crisis. We're in this situation because of increasing levels of ozone. Ozone is a chemical reaction in the atmosphere created by the combination of VOCs and nitrogen oxides, catalyzed by heat. So global warming increases ozone levels throughout the entire globe. In fact, we're now seeing ozone levels in southern Utah in rural places higher than in Los Angeles, simply because the precursors of ozone can be disseminated globally and the heating of the atmosphere. We're in this situation because of the aridification of the American West. This is a picture of wind blowing across the Owens Lake, or what used to be the Owens Lake. And now dust storms have been created that makes the dry lake bed of what once was the Owens Lake one of the largest sources of pollution in the United States. And unfortunately, that's what's happening with the Great Salt Lake. These two satellite photos show on the left what the Great Salt Lake looked like in 1989 and what it looked like in 2015. And if we had a current satellite photo to compare, it would be even smaller. So unfortunately, for multiple reasons, we're headed in the direction of making the Great Salt Lake an additional source of air pollution whenever the wind blows. Now the lake is so dry that you can virtually walk all the way to Antelope Island. Now, this is an actual photograph of the Utah legislature in session, and it could have been taken in any one of the last 20 years. But the legislature obviously has a gift for ignoring science, reality, and evidence before their eyes. Yes, Utah is special, but it's not actually its own solar system. Utah is part of a planet, and that planet is in peril. You can see multiple little snippets and evidence of what we are all experiencing in the American West right now. We had the highest temperature Salt Lake City has ever recorded a couple of weeks ago. We are in the grips of another heat wave now, as is the rest of the West, unprecedented. And yet the Utah legislature, instead of dealing with any of this, has now figured out a way to make it worse. In the end of the session of 2018, they actually went from ignoring the problem to making it worse by sawing off the environmental branches that we all depend on through their proposal of the Dirty Energy Inland Port, basically creating 25 square miles of boiling over environmental disaster. Now, what does that mean in particular with regard to air quality? And by the way, Utah voters in the vote, this is another photograph of Utah voters in the voting booth. Part of what Deeda and I want to try and accomplish this morning is to make you so concerned, i.e. you're mad as hell and you're not gonna take it anymore, and you're going to talk to your friends and your neighbors, and you're going to say, this is not a future we have to put up with. As bad as it is now, it's going to get worse, and we can do something about it. So if I can share any image that's lasting for you in trying to give you an idea of what air pollution does to the human body, I want you to think of air pollution as the same as smoking cigarettes, because it acts almost identical to that. In fact, on a day like today, it's like this kind of smoking cigarettes. This is obviously a BYU fraternity stunt. All the same diseases we know are related to smoking are related to air pollution exposure. Multiple types of heart insults, heart attacks, heart failure, heart arrhythmias, strokes, acceleration of the aging process, sudden death, cancers, brain diseases, cognitive loss, behavioral disorders, even crime, all types of lung diseases, impaired fetal development, poor pregnancy outcomes, and endocrine disorders like type 2 diabetes. We used to estimate that 1 to 2,000 deaths occur annually in Utah due to our air pollution, but a recent study involving multiple experts in the state of Utah have now recommended that estimate be increased to 2,500 to as many as 8,000 deaths annually in Utah, with the average person losing between 1.1 and 3.6 years of their life due to the air pollution that we breathe. Some people lose as much as 5 years. So I want to talk about a couple of simple concepts about air pollution that are not discussed in the media. It may not be discussed with your physician and certainly aren't ever discussed on Capitol Hill. The first is, there is no safe level of air pollution. Some of the world's best researchers plotted three types of air pollution against a signature health outcome, which is sudden death. On the horizontal axis, you can see going to the right, concentrations increasing of air pollution, i.e. number of cigarettes smoked firsthand, secondhand cigarette smoke, and community air pollution. On the vertical axis is the incidence of sudden death. You can see right at the beginning of that graph is the steepest part of the association, meaning that per unit of exposure, the tightest correlation with health outcomes is when the air pollution levels are raised, are very low, actually. That is reflected by research that shows smoking one cigarette a day is nearly half as much risk as smoking an entire pack. Looking at this graph a little more, in a little more detail, you can see that as the air pollution or the cigarette smoking increases, the consequence actually starts to decrease per unit of exposure. So if you tell a typical legislator this, they'll say, oh, well, if that's true, that means that the worse our air quality is, we don't have to really worry about it as much. However, I would say, let's look at it with what we can learn from those green arrows, which is that there is no safe level of air pollution. And it's even more important to make our air cleaner when it's already reasonably clean. In other words, every bit of air pollution matters and has health consequences. The third principle is that even short-term air pollution exposure matters. If a fetus is developing in its mother's womb and the mother is exposed to even a weekend of significant air pollution, unfortunately, like we're experiencing right now, that can have lifelong consequences to that person. The air pollution you breathed in January can still be inside your body in April, still causing disease and inflammation. To illustrate that, here are some autopsy specimens of lungs. On the left-hand side is a non-smoker from a healthy person who lived in a rural part of Australia and exposed to little air pollution. On the other side is also a non-smoker, but a city dweller of Sydney, Australia, which averages less air pollution than Salt Lake City. You can see the lung is gray as if the person was a smoker, but it wasn't. And those little black dots are deposits of carbon inhaled that the person never got rid of. In fact, we know that there are multiple routes of exposure. It isn't a matter of just what you inhale. Air pollution can actually attach itself to the mucosa lining your nose and then attach to the nerves lining the inside of your nose, and then acting as if it were on a conveyor belt, migrating actually back to your brainstem and penetrating the brain itself. In fact, you can also absorb air pollution from your skin, which brings up my favorite air pollution study. Researchers wanted to know how much PAH pollution a person would expose if they went to a barbecue. PAH is the acronym for polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, and the compound benzene is the mother compound of that group. Polycyclic means these are multiple benzene rings. They're very toxic in high concentrations in cigarette smoke, wood smoke, and diesel exhaust. They're also in high concentrations in barbecue smoke. So the researchers are trying to figure out what's the greatest route of exposure here to PAHs. Well, the first route of exposure, the most important, was what they ate from the barbecue. But the second route of exposure was what they absorbed through their skin, to the point where they actually found that the attendees of the barbecue saturated their clothes with so much PAH pollution that they recommended that anybody attending a barbecue go home and change their clothes because of continued absorption of PAH pollution if they continued to wear their clothes. So the moral of that story is never go to a barbecue naked. And then there are additional morals to the story, which is you can absorb pollution from multiple routes. The next principle is it isn't just winter inversions, like today. There's much more pollution today than what we might actually experience on a typical winter day. Again, think of that graph that I showed you a few minutes ago. Even when the air pollution isn't much of a visible impairment of our landscape, it's still having significant health harm. On a day like today, as much as there is particulate air pollution that clouds our sky, perhaps an even worse exposure is the amount of ozone in our atmosphere. The EPA's threshold for, quote, a safe level of ozone is 70 parts per billion. And I want to show you how badly out of date that is. Researchers found that studying a population of over 7,000 people for 18 years, just 3 parts per billion exposure over 10 years created the equivalent of 29 years of smoking a pack a day of cigarettes in terms of loss of lung function and loss of lung tissue. Timing is critical when it comes to air pollution. Again, a fetus developing in its mother's womb, exposed to just short-term air pollution of maybe just a weekend, like we're experiencing now, can have lifelong consequences. On the other end of the health spectrum, someone who is elderly and on the verge of a heart attack or a stroke, the amount of inflammation triggered by the air pollution we're experiencing today may be enough to bump them over the edge into a heart attack or a stroke, or maybe even kill them. Pollution particles, now we know, are embedded in all of our critical organs, not just our lungs, including the brain, including even the placenta. We now know that newborns are actually born pre-polluted, if you will, and that should be a disturbing thought to anybody. That concept triggered this headline from CNN a couple of years ago: exposure to air pollution before birth may shorten our lives. Indeed, even prenatal exposure can shorten your life, reducing your life expectancy by a few years and maybe even more. Now we know it's even worse than that. Even preconception exposure can cause chronic disease. Those adults who are planning on having children but haven't yet done so, the air pollution they are breathing now is having an impact on their genetic integrity and their epigenetic functionality, such that they are actually having their future children's health impacted by the air pollution they're breathing today. For example, multiple generations can be harmed by a single exposure. A pregnant mother is obviously harmed herself by exposure. Her fetus is, as I just mentioned. But if the fetus is a female, that fetus's eggs are also developing. And so by one weekend of air pollution, three generations of human beings can be exposed to air pollution that affects their health. In fact, studies in invertebrates have found that that may actually be 11 generations, not just three. So the air pollution inhaled today impairs the lifelong health of not only individuals that we live with, love, friends, and neighbors, but the health of future generations as well. So how does this relate to the inland port? It's about 25 square miles of a multimodal transportation hub and gigantic warehouse farm that will involve the transportation of millions of containers a year, brought here by dozens of double stack trains every day. So we're talking about not only dozens of new train trips, and put that in this context, a diesel locomotive may put out as much pollution as maybe 10 to 15,000 cars. It will also involve dozens of diesel switcher engines. And these are some of the dirtiest sources of pollution anywhere, because these diesel switcher engines are some of the oldest generation of diesels ever made. In fact, Union Pacific operates about 40 of these diesel switcher engines on the Wasatch Front. And most of them are either tier zero or tier zero plus in terms of the pollution they put out. We estimate that there will be 70,000 more semi-trucks on our roads every day related to the port, 150,000 more vehicles related to the port. So that's obviously greater freeway congestion, more dangerous freeways, and we expect we'll have increased pressure for UDOT to start making plans for double decking I-15 as a result. The satellite ports that Deeda mentioned will open the floodgates for the extraction industries to produce more coal, coal ash, oil, gas, oil shale, and tar sands. This is a statement by researchers examining the air quality effects of inland ports. They said the air quality impacts of ports are significant. They are particularly large emissions of diesel exhaust, particulate matter, and nitrogen oxides. The switcher engines that I talked about in a couple of slides previous to this are actually a significant contributor to, as Deeda mentioned, what is termed now in California the diesel death zone. Let me put that in a little more perspective. Researchers calculated that all the diesel engines in the LA port created as much pollution as 480,000 cars which is almost half of all the cars registered in the state of Utah. We know that air traffic also is a significant contributor to air pollution, and put that in this, this context, a study of LAX found that the airport was responsible for half as much pollution as all the cars on all their freeways. So this expansion of our airport, as well as tying the inland port to more air traffic, is going to be an additional source of increased pollution. And then add to that what we expect will be at least 20 years of constant construction dust. If you go out there now, you will see scenes like this constantly kicked up, and that will go on for 20 years if this is built out to meet the aspirations of the port cheerleaders. The inland port, this pollution will not disperse equally throughout the airshed. It will concentrate in the community already grossly affected by the worst industrial pollution in the Salt Lake Valley. We also know that freeways are significant sources of pollution, and that people within a few hundred yards of freeways can be exposed to as much as 30 times more of the ultrafine portion of particulate air pollution as people even a half a mile away. So another way that this community will be victimized far beyond what the rest of us experience. So it's actually kind of creating license to create on the west side, North Salt Lake, and West Bountiful, a sacrifice zone for everyone else. Now, in addition to that, we already know that 90% of northern Utah dust comes from the dry lake beds of shrinking lakes, especially the Great Salt Lake. The water usage of the inland port will only accelerate that. And that particular issue is now getting national and international attention. This was a headline from the Associated Press just last week. Wildlife and air quality are at risk as the Great Salt Lake nears a low. Speaking of wind blowing environmental disasters, sorry about that. So the inland port is basically a gateway to turning Salt Lake City in 2040 into the Pittsburgh of 1940. I can't imagine any of us would want any scenario that even closely approximate that. A couple of years ago, the Tribune editorialized about it with some degree of concern. They said, we hear a lot about building a green port, and that's good, but there's no scenario where this is anything close to zero emissions. We need aggressive countermeasures on other pollution sources. The politicians who will this port into existence carry the responsibility to reduce its harm. We need to reduce pollution elsewhere to ensure the inland port genuinely improves Utah's lives. Well, as true as that is, this is my response. Offsets? Countermeasures? What are we talking about? If there were actually offsets and countermeasures that would mitigate the inland port, why haven't we not adopted them already? It's absolutely absurd to believe that there are offsets and countermeasures that can make the pollution from the inland port acceptable. If there were, why haven't we done them already? So we all want air quality that looks like this. Unfortunately, we're headed in the opposite direction. So I implore all of you who have sat through the presentation that Deeda and I tried to stumble through with this technological problem, we encourage you to join forces with those of us who are already working hard to stop the polluting port, because our future is literally at stake. And if you want to know about what air pollution does to the human body, I encourage you to read either of the two books that I've recently had published. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Brian and Deeda, for the great presentation. We've had one question that's come through about the mosquito pesticide spraying in the Northwest Quadrant. Dr. Moench, could you discuss issues related to mosquito spraying?
Absolutely. we didn't actually know that the Salt Lake City Mosquito Abatement District was routinely, year after year, aerial spraying pesticides over the Northwest Quadrant until we found out that they, in fact, then tried to ramp up the whole project and involve the United States Air Force. In digging into that issue, we were alarmed to find out that they have been doing this literally for decades. So when we discovered that was in fact the routine practice of the Salt Lake City Mosquito Abatement District, we decided that we better dig into the issue. And so I had 13 of my colleagues help me with an investigation of what were the health consequences of the mosquito pesticides that they were using. And we published a report 63 pages long and have distributed already widely, but we'd like other people, anybody who hasn't read it, to continue to explore it. It's a lot to get through. And we perused the medical literature to the point where we have something like 270 references supporting our contention. But it's simply this. It is time for the Salt Lake City Mosquito Abatement District to stop this practice. Other cities have been able to find more holistic methods of controlling mosquitoes. Boulder City, Colorado, Madison, Wisconsin are two very good examples. We know, for instance, that epidemiologic studies show that these kinds of pesticides are associated with impaired brain development in children, including higher rates of autism in populations that are exposed to exactly the same chemicals and exactly the same delivery system as what the Salt Lake City Mosquito Abatement District is doing. So it's time for them to stop. In fact, there are studies that show that these pesticides don't even reduce the mosquito population because mosquitoes are rapidly developing resistance to them, and they don't reduce the incidence of West Nile virus. And we should put West Nile virus in a different perspective than what is commonly thought of. We only had two cases of West Nile virus in the entire state of Utah last year, and only one of them was serious. Now, unfortunately, with the climate crisis, we're going to have probably a growing mosquito population. So if we continue to pour pesticides in the Northwest Quadrant as a means of addressing that problem, it may actually not only not address the problem, but make it worse. So part of our project to try and alert the public to the environmental dangers of the inland port is to make them aware of the fact that it's time for Salt Lake City to stop spraying pesticides from airplanes over the Northwest Quadrant.
Thank you, Brian. Council member James Rogers tells us that this will be the greenest inland port in history. Is there such a thing as a green inland port?
No, there are no green ports anywhere in the world. And the technology to green this port in any way is really lacking. Electric trucks, for example, are just in their very infancy in terms of development. The approach that proponents of the port have taken is to try, I don't know if you're familiar with the term greenwashing, but a lot of companies do this thing where they pretend to be environmentally sustainable by using certain language or promising certain things, but there's really no substance to it. And that's what's happening with this project. They say things, vague things like, oh, it's going to be green. That's really vague. And don't substantiate that with factual information about how that's going to happen. And as you notice from both my and Brian's presentations, there's pollution happening from the construction out there right now that is not being addressed. And there's nothing sustainable about the development that's happening out there right now. So push back when you hear somebody say that and say, explain to me actually how that's supposed to happen because they don't have the detail.
Well, I want to push back on one particular issue that is often brought up in terms of claiming that this will be a green inland port. a lot of that rests on the idea that some of these pollution sources will be electrified and therefore not emit locally. Well, two things about that. Most of that electricity right now would still come from coal-fired power plants elsewhere. But the other thing is that we now know that probably 50 to 60% of the pollution that a vehicle is responsible for is non-tailpipe, meaning it is generated by mechanical friction, brake dust, and road dust, and nothing to do with the combustion engine itself. And in fact, electric vehicles and electric trucks are routinely heavier than internal combustion vehicles. So that aspect of it may get worse. So if tomorrow, every vehicle in the Salt Lake Valley, every single truck was all electrified, you wouldn't reduce pollution like you think you would, because you'd still have all this non-tailpipe pollution, which we will have no matter how many vehicles are electrified 30 years from now.
Our next question is about using the legal system and lawsuits. Deeda, you've had experience with Southern Utah Wilderness Alliance and its successful efforts in halting environmental insanity by using the court system. Since lobbying Utah legislators has proven to be such a fruitless and perhaps at times even counterproductive tactic, when they go into full reactionary defensive mode, shouldn't the primary mechanism be suing the state and the port in court? And related, what are the implications of a case currently before the Utah Supreme Court? What sort of decision is required to mitigate the worst of these outcomes? So the legal route.
Right. So I'll start with the easier part of the answer, which is that the litigation that's making its way through the Utah court system is now at the point where we're awaiting the Utah Supreme Court to issue an opinion. And so there was a hearing a few months ago, and what this litigation is about. This litigation was brought by Salt Lake City. The defendants are the state of Utah and the Utah Inland Port Authority. And what's at issue is that the city is saying, and we agree with this position, that that Utah, the state, and the Inland Port Authority are usurping Salt Lake City's rightful and state constitutionally protected land use authority under something called the Ripper Clause. And literally what that means is that the authority has been ripped away from Salt Lake City. So the Supreme Court had a virtual hearing. The city attorney made a very persuasive case. There are 5 justices on the Utah Supreme Court, and 3 of them were asking questions favorable to our side. So we could get a favorable opinion from the court, or it could be sort of a split opinion. But what does that mean? I know that's what everyone's asking themselves. Well, it could mean that Salt Lake City then has all the authority given back to it. This means that we wouldn't be dealing with the Utah Inland Port Authority anymore. We'd be dealing solely with Salt Lake City. Or it could be some kind of split decision something more nuanced where the city gets some of its authority back. That doesn't totally solve our problem within the Stop the Polluting Port Coalition, because as you might have heard me say during my presentation, Salt Lake City is very complicit in enabling this development. So we would then need to really work with the city to make sure that they uphold their interest in creating, so this is the phraseology they use, an eco-industrial development. That's what's in this master plan the city passed for this area. And it's kind of an oxymoron, eco-industrial. And right now it's not getting implemented in any meaningful way. So with regard to other litigation hooks, there might be some if there are violations of the Clean Air Act or the Clean Water Act. So there, that would be at the federal level. But the developers have been very careful to be submitting their projects on a parcel by parcel basis, which doesn't show what the landscape level harm that's going to happen from this project. So there are definitely efforts on their side to prevent us from having options for litigation. But we're looking at all of that constantly because, yes, litigation could be a very helpful thing for us.
Let me add to that, that we have had two meetings with the EPA in an attempt to try and convince them that there are avenues within the Clean Air Act for them to actually become engaged in this issue and hopefully protect the community. The EPA tries to be as non-political as possible. They have also met with the Inland Port Authority, but we're trying to show them that in fact, there are tools within the Clean Air Act to rein in the perhaps the worst aspects of this. We don't know to this extent yet if the EPA is going to jump in and do anything to protect us, but we are exploring that route as well. Basically, every route possible, we're exploring simultaneously. But I think where the public's opposition to this comes into play is primarily this. If it is clear to business leaders and politicians as well, that the Salt Lake Valley residents really don't want this, then it's going to be hard for businesses to actually justify being part of it because their name's going to be dragged through the mud. And believe me, one of the things we're going to do is we're going to continue to highlight Rio Tinto's pivotal role here. And Rio Tinto does have some concern about what their public relations image is like. And we're going to make sure that the people know that if this gets billed out, it will be in large part because Rio Tinto reneged on their commitment, if you want to call it a commitment, to establish in their private property, they're the biggest property owner in the Inland Port area, as a conservation area. They would, if they renege on that, we're going to make sure that the public knows. And that's going to create a PR problem for them. Now, do they care? They're an international company and then maybe they don't care as much, but other local businesses are going to also have their names attached to this. And I think they're going to be reluctant to participate in it if the public is clearly united in opposing it.
Thank you, Brian and Deeda on that. This is about working with other groups. The question, is there any way for you to make your presentation to the Utah legislature? Is there any chance that they might even listen?
We have a slideshow presentation that one of our amazing volunteers put together. His name's David Shear. That is available for people to use. If you have a community group that you would like to talk to about this issue, the slideshow with the notes, the script that goes with it, is available for anybody to use. I think, you know, the challenge with the legislature is a special challenge. And that is going to require more one-on-one or more, and you know, we've had a problem because of the pandemic. It's really changed how we're able to organize, but meetings with individual legislators was something that we were doing right before the pandemic struck. And we need to get back to that. But you know, Brian's right that the pressure needs to come from all of us on all of our elected officials. And so another area that's been very fruitful for us is that we have good access to Salt Lake City. And there are city council races that are happening right now. And I think it's really important to talk to the candidates. There actually are a couple on this call today about this issue and ask them what they think about the proposed port and what they intend to do to protect us from this development. So focusing on the elections that are coming up is an immediate tangible thing. We have a committee working on that. If people want to get involved, we're happy to have them involved, and because we're people powered. And we're also doing a lot of tabling in the fall when things start to come back to, you know, more in-person events. And we can definitely use volunteers for that as well. We have a great host of LTE writers and op-ed writers, and just, it's really anything that you can do in your life to help people understand what this problem is. And if you know elected officials, certainly talk to them about it. One, I'll just say one more thing. Salt Lake County has been sort of missing in all of this, and we really do need to reach out to county, to Jenny Wilson and to the county council.
I'll just put a plug in, is as you can see, there's a lot of work to be done, and the coalition meets weekly on Thursday evenings from 6 to 7 p.m. And there's a link on the stopthepollutingport.org website /events where you can get that link and attend a meeting where you're hearing about all the very current things, and there's opportunities to get involved and get involved with the various different groups. And as Deeda and Brian have mentioned, there are folks on this call today who are leaders of those efforts, like Nancy McHugh and Stan Holmes. Liz Waite has been attending some of the sessions. So there's a good number of folks that are involved.
Yeah, I noticed on the picture of the Zoom call, there were a lot of familiar faces there.
Exactly.
Can I just mention one other thing about the importance of public involvement? I can think of at least five projects along the Wasatch Front or proposals from polluting industries that didn't happen because the citizens demanded that it not. Stericycle, the medical waste incinerator, is going to be having to shut down next year because of public opposition. A garbage to energy proposal in Draper didn't happen because the citizens pushed back. A petroleum coke burning power plant that was proposed in 2010 for the Holly oil refinery site didn't happen because literally hundreds and hundreds of Davis County people showed up and demanded that it not happen. And then we met with the CEO of Zions Bank that was going to finance the project. And we met with Governor John Huntsman. And we said, in no way are you going to do this to this community. And it didn't happen. Governor Gary Herbert changed his position on the Las Vegas water grab after citizens spoke out and demanded that he not sign the Las Vegas water grab, which would have dewatered the Great Basin Desert and created a dust bowl that would have blown over Salt Lake City every time the wind blew. Now, we've got other sources of problems, as Deeda and I both iterated here this morning, but those are a handful of examples of things that didn't happen because the citizens fought back. So we can make this happen as well, but it will take massive citizen involvement and pushback.
Okay, I've got question about on folks to reach out to, like so someone says the governor is pro port, how can we change his position? And someone else has asked, have you met with the LDS church leaders about helping to mitigate the inland port? And a third group, what are your thoughts on gradually increasing the carbon tax with the rebate to citizens, such that as that proposed by the Citizens Climate Lobby? So three more groups to reach out to. Brian, Deeda?
Well, I'll just say the governor, and then Brian can talk about the church as he's a member. We just need to probably ask for a meeting with the governor. I think that it's worth, you know, and we've had that on our to-do list. So that's the answer there. We've not met with him. Brian,
well,
the LDS church?
Well, it's not because we didn't ask. We got shunted to one of his assistants. But we're going to continue to ask. Now, with regard to the LDS church, a handful of us did meet by Zoom last August with representatives of the LDS church. And we tried to give them a presentation very similar to what we gave you, minus some of my rude remarks. But yes, we have targeted them as an obviously a tremendously influential group in this battle. And in fact, I should say that one of the first and most important public presentations that our physicians group did back in 2009 was a formal presentation on air pollution to the Quorum of the 12 Apostles of the LDS Church and all their general authorities. So we have done that, and we will continue to explore every opportunity to tell this story to any audience that will listen, both kingpins and power brokers and politicians of every stripe, as well as the public.
Did you want to comment on the thoughts on gradually increasing carbon tax with a rebate to citizens, such as the Citizens Climate Lobby proposes?
Well, I think that's a great idea. I don't have any problem with that at all. Whatever it will take for us to ratchet down very quickly our dependency on fossil fuels, we're all for it.
Okay. Thank you. This is one having to do with the children. We know that you've given information about the effects of pollution on children and the unborn. Can you add some descriptions of what parents can consider for their children's lives? About 34% of West Valley City is 18 years old and younger.
Well, let me say that the impact of air pollution on health is actually inversely proportional to how old you are. If you're at the embryonic stage of life in your mother's womb, air pollution exposure at that stage is more critical than at any other. And then 3 months gestation in your mother's womb is probably the next most critical stage. And then infancy, and then childhood, and then young adulthood. People our age, the battle's already lost. Pardon my cynicism. No, that's not true. But the important message is air pollution is the overall public health impact of air pollution on a population is more centered around what it does to young people than anybody else. We are affecting their health for the rest of their life. I wish I had time to show you all these slides that I could have shown you in autopsy studies. Studies that show pollution particles embedded in the hearts of people in their 40s and 50s to the tune of 2 to 22 billion nanoparticles of pollution invading the hearts of young people per gram of heart tissue. When I mention these pollution particles invade every single critical organ in your body, I mean it. I mean the heart, the lungs, the brain, the placenta, the pancreas, absolutely everything. And it wreaks biological havoc. So young people are actually affected even more than old people because they have so much longer to live and they're at critical developmental stages. A community that wants to think of itself as family friendly should have air quality number one in terms of protecting the lives of their children.
Thank you, Brian. So what's the most promising possibility? What do you think is the most effective way for us to protect those children? And do the work that you're doing.
Yeah. Well, we have to take this seriously to agree none of us ever have before. Last 2 years ago, I kept track of how many days of quote clean air we had throughout the summer. This was 2 years ago, and last year was even worse. We didn't have a single clean green air day from the middle of June to the middle of September 2 years ago. We had a similar situation last year. We are headed in the same direction this year. Unfortunately, what we're seeing today is going to be routine, not just for the summer, but it'll start to creep into May and then April and last through October. So we're on the doorstep of a dystopian future, as I mentioned in my slide presentation. So it's not going to get better unless we get involved. It's only going to get worse.
So I just want to say, and the way to get involved is whatever works for you. You know, if you are not a meeting person, but you like writing LTEs, write some letters to the editor. If, you know, whatever feels comfortable for you, we're an organic coalition. People come and go as their lives change. You know, there's no guilt. Whatever skills and talents you have to bring to the group, we welcome. So please join us. Join us if you're so inclined, and help us protect our community. And I think how this issue goes has implications for how lots of other issues go. Like, what I've learned in my years of organizing is that it's all connected. And so the work that we're doing to stop the polluting port is also, generally speaking, work to create a livable, sustainable community for everybody.
Let me just add to that. Talk to your friends and neighbors. Talk to your family. Make sure that everyone that knows you knows this is how you feel about it.
Thank you so much, Deeda and Brian, and everyone who attended this presentation. You've given us a lot to think about and to act on. And remember that Thursdays, 6 to 7 p.m. is when those meetings are. And you can come and listen to all the work that's being done and jump in where it works and feels right for you to get involved in stopping the polluting Utah inland port. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everybody. And appreciate you all joining us. And we hope to see you all again next Sunday, when we will be joined by Aaron Mendenhall.